So hello everyone, today we are with Mr. Mudassir. So can you give us a small introduction about you?
Hi all, my name is Mudassir Bashir. So I'm doing my PhD at NIT Warangal in Department of Electronics and Communication Engineering. So I'm working in analog mixed signal VLSI design. I joined PhD in 2014, July. Before that I did my M.tech at Shri Mata Vaishno Devi University, Katra, in 2012 to 2014 batch. So there I worked in RF VLSI design.
So actually just to tell you guys, we both are from same batch and same college. So we have done our masters together. So he took a different path, I took a different path. So he was more interested in doing PhD and research. Yes, so that is why he joined research in NIT Warangal. So before we started, so sir, can you elaborate something about PhD? What is PhD and how, if for example a candidate wanted to join PhD, then what are the criteria should he consider to join PhD, or should he join PhD or not?
See, doing PhD, it's totally different from other degrees. Like in case of B.Tech or M.Tech, I'll be completing in 2 years M.Tech, or I'll be completing my B.Tech in 4 years. But when you join for PhD, so it's totally a different concept. So first of all, you should be very much aware about the challenge that will be in PhD when you are going to do it, the institute where you are going to, the area of research you are going to. So whenever you are trying to think about this PhD thing, so you should first know whether why you are doing this PhD. Are you like interested in that, or someone is suggesting you, or your parents are insisting you, or you are not getting any job? So this has to be kept in mind. So while joining PhD, many of people these days, what they think that getting stipend up, because in PhD now it's common we are getting at least a stipend of 28,000. So some people think like getting 28,000 per month, like it's like a job. So if I'm not getting any job, I'll do PhD. But I think that's not right, because the amount of stress and the amount of time which you'll be spending in PhD, if you spend the same time in some company for let's say 20k per month, within 3 years you will be reaching to that amount which you will get after PhD also. So it is there. And sometimes what happens, if your parents are insisting you to do, then I think you should not join it, because the interest should be within, and you should be very sure about this, what actually a PhD is. Many people when they are joining, I have met many of my juniors who when they join, so I ask them, so do you know about the area of research you are going to work, or do you know what you are going to do in PhD? They tell, yeah, we know. But it's not like that. Everyone is like, they are very much confident at that time. Okay, I got admission to PhD, now it's okay, I'll see now. Somehow I'll do some things. But that's not how it works. When 1 year is over, then the actual game starts. So people start complaining about their progress of research and all that. So it is, you have to be very much, your that commitment should be very much towards PhD. Then you'll be able to complete in within the that 4 years of time, or you'll be completing it with less stress, without affecting your personal life, without affecting your relatives, families, etc.
Okay, so what should be the procedure to take admission in PhD? I mean, what is the basic procedure? As
I had done B.Tech and M.Tech, so I did my GATE. So there are three ways now. Recently, one more is there. For B.Tech people, first I'll talk about M.Tech people, what should we do? Or some are from MSc Electronics, let's say, because I'm from ECE, so I'll talk about MSc Electronics. So what should they do? If you go for NIDs, IITs, they'll mostly prefer people who had done M.Tech. And first thing, second thing is, they are having a valid GATE score. Yes, in some NIDs, if you go, almost every NID, they have their own written test, which is almost based on GATE syllabus. So once you go for there, once you are able to qualify the written test, then the other stage is for interview. And in case of like IITs or IIC Bangalore, if you go there, it's mostly based on interview and your area of research. So and if you are able to do good in the interview, you may have chance of getting. So GATE is not a criteria there. Coming to other university like central universities or their science universities, there yes, net is required there. So mostly they'll take based on net, and some interview will be there. And other thing is, they can take you as a JRF. So if you are working good, your progress is good, after 1 year or 2 year, they will convert you into PhD student, and you can take this, the work you have done in JRF, you can take that that as a part of your PhD work also. So I think in June, July, yearly two times there is this admission advertisement will come for PhD. So in June it comes around May, I think, and then one comes in December. So whenever you are applying for, it comes in NITs and IITs. That's a simple procedure for, it's not too much complicated. And you can follow different NITs sites. There are also some Facebook pages are there which give the regular notification about these PhD admissions. So I think nowadays a lot of money is invested in this research. So if you are not able to, what happens? We are getting a stipend up to 5 years now. Earlier it used to be up to 4 years. Now we are getting a stipend up to 5 years. So what if you are not able to complete it within 5 years? So there are many side projects which Government of India is giving to institutes. From there you can also claim stipend. So there is no need to worry about what will happen if we won't complete. Yes, you should complete by 4 years. And this is how you should. This is the procedure for getting admission at NITs or IITs.
For example, let us say a student is preparing for PhD admissions. Mm-hmm. And he has done his B.Tech and he has done his Masters, that is M.Tech. Now, this is different strategy that the student has to follow if he has done MSc or he has done M.Tech. For example, a student who is having a B.Tech background,
mm-hmm.
then he will be having a GATE exam as a standard exam, and with the help of this GATE exam, he will be able to write the written examination for the PhD admissions. But for the students who have done MS, MSc, or MCA, then they have to go through the UGC NET examination or CSI NET examination,
mm-hmm.
in their respective domains. Now, if the basic criteria sometimes is that a student has to write, he has to clear the GATE examination or he has to clear the UGC NET examination, and then only he is eligible to write the written test paper over there, just to get admissions for the written test, and then he has to face the interviews. Then only he is going to get the admissions in PhD.
Right.
Plus his problem statement should be very, very good, because he should also define clearly what is the area of research or what is the
mm-hmm.
domain of research. Now my question is that what should be the strategy for preparation? Like for example, if a student is going to attempt the interviews for IIT Delhi, let us say, or any given IIT,
mm-hmm.
then they are going to take the written examination. Then what should be the strategy to prepare for admissions for PhD?
So I'll go one by one. I'll start with B.Tech. So this year I think Government of India they have started this taking direct admission for PhD from B.Tech students. The criteria for that is if you have done B.Tech from government colleges, or you have a valid GATE score. If as a B.Tech student you are wearing valid good, you can directly apply for PhD admission at any IIT or NITs. So yes, you'll be getting a good stipend. As compared to VPL, you'll be getting around 60,000. So that is the intention to grab this, because I think Government of India wants more young scholars to come and do some intelligent work. So that's why they are planning to recruit this B.Tech people. So now coming to M.Tech. So I think now it was there earlier that all the NITs they use ask for a valid GATE score, but now it's not it's an optional, it's a plus point, but it's not compulsory. And yes, there will be this their own exam that will be GATE based, and once you qualify the GATE their written exam, then you have to go for an interview. So yeah, these are for M.Tech people. Now if I'm an MSc electronics, or I'm from MC, or I want to do a PhD in computer science or like that. So people are taking different paths. Like one is if you don't have that much time and all that, you are directly going for UGC NET, and if you qualify it, you can join as a PhD student at some university, or if you want to at like IIC Bangalore, if you want to go or some other. So there you can join as a JRF. So after 1 year or 2 year, based on your performance, your guide he may convert you from GRF to PhD. So that's good. And other ways people are doing now with MCA or MSc, they are doing this GATE. So once they are qualifying GATE, they are joining as an M.Tech student. Then after M.Tech, it is similar like PhD. So that is this thing. So yes, what should be the strategy to going for admissions? What should be your plan? So first thing, yes, written is like GATE exam. So there is nothing much about that thing. So interview is very important, I think. Yes, written if you have done good, but if your interview is not that good, I think they won't take you. So you have to convince them you are very much interested in research. So first of all, you should be knowing what areas you are interested in. Those areas should be based on your like M.tech project or MCA you have done any project. They should be related to that area. That is first thing. And second thing is, I think I have experienced this thing that they'll be asking you the subjects you have been your course of during your M.tech and your MCA. I'll be talking at M.tech in general, so you can take it as an MCA also. So coursework, it should be on your tips, the names of subjects, which subjects you have read, and the research you have done. Just a brief outline you have to give what you have done in your M.tech project and why you are interested in this area. So these are very important things. And what you are planning to do future, is there any future work you want to continue that work or not, like that. Although it's going to change once you join, but for that time of period, you should be very much confident about, I had done my M.tech in this topic, so I want to do more work in that because I'm finding some scope there. And this is one thing. Second thing is, if you are having some publications, like not some, I think one is enough. IEEE, at least one IEEE conference should be there. So that it gives that mentor, whoever is interested in your area or whoever faculty is interested in you, it gives him an idea that this guy knows how to read paper, this guy knows how to write papers. He's having a bit this mind about this writing, because if you are doing PhD, you are doing some good work, but you are not able to write it properly. You are not able to present it to research world. So it's of no use. So that is also a plus point. So I think one more is there. In recently the trends, earlier it used to be like PhD people used to join after 30-32 years. Now it is there that as soon as you are doing your M.tech or MCA or masters, so it's better to if you join as soon as possible, because he's going to that mentor he's going to take you, because once the age comes, this there will many issues will be there, family issues will be there, your mind will be busy with something, you have to go to and fro to whom and all that, so they don't like it. So it should be there. So I think the strategy is to make your coursework should be very much in your mind of your M.tech, and then the area of research which you are interested in, and it should be related to your M.tech work. So these are the two things. And third one, I think that is the important one. So before you are interested in any shoot, NIT or IIT, so shortlist the faculty members who are related to your area and try to meet them before going for exam and interview. So that if you go in person to talk to them, and once you are in interview, he will be hanging this thing already in his mind about you, that he came to me and he is interested in this area and all that thing. So it's better to talk in person also before going for the exam and interview. I think these three studies I think work for most of the people.
So you are now in third year of PhD, right?
Yeah.
So how was your experience so far in the last 3 years?
First year starts with it's like a part of M.tech, so it's like a coursework. So mostly it will be around 14 credits. So some people they do this credit coursework in one semester. Some people they do in 1 year. So it depends on you and your guide. So what in most of the institutes, what happens? The first year we are supposed to do this coursework and finding the problem, like some recent trends what are there in your field, we try to find it, and we try to implement some novelty or something which will give some slight edge for our work compared to the present work. So that's what we do in first year. And a lot of research work, literature survey, a lot of literature survey we do. So yes, first year for now, like I'm in I'm about to complete my third year. So first year is about coursework and doing finding your problem statement. So once you are able to find not problem statement, like area, we have to converge, like from research area I'm going to okay this application, then problem statement what. So by the end of your 1.5 third semester, in the middle of your second year, you should be able to specify your problem properly, and a lot of literature survey should be done. So and not only reading, you have to tabulate everything, like you can keep it on system or on some logbook you can make, and make every based on the operating principle, based on the application, based on the year, and like that strategies. What should I do? Proper plan of your literature survey should be there. then by the fourth, by the end of fourth semester, you should be able to implement some of the already present architectures. Let's say some architectures are there, or some algorithms are there. You should be able to implement them by the end of fourth semester. So when you come to third year, so now you should be able to, once you have done all this, then you will be able to do your whatever you are planning to do. You will be able, because your basics are clear, everything is clear. And during I think first year and second year, there are some online video lectures are there from YouTube, NAPTAL you can go, or MIT open course is there. And their topics, the subjects which are related to you, I think they are very much useful to clear your basics and all that, because what they teach you, they go to their approach like more like a research, like, so your basics will be, when once your basics is done, so your speed of work in PhD, it will be very much quick. So yes, most of your PhD depends on how you are doing literature survey, because in first and second year most of people try to enjoy their time, because guide is not back at you, so you try to enjoy your new campus and all that, that PhD stardom, etc. So I think early you start, there is one, this proverb is very, early you start, more quick you will complete. So if you start very much quickly, by the end of 3 year and 3.5 year, you may be able to complete. It depends also on area. Some areas are there where it takes 4 year, 4.5 year. Some areas are there we take 3 and 3.5. It depends on, on that. So there is one more thing is there, when we are going for our research problem, so there is two things is there. One is, if some already some existing techniques are there, art, let's say articles are there, codes are there, I'm trying to work on them, the competition is too much there. But if you go for new algorithm or new something, okay, there is risk is I may not get results, but competition is less. So if you are able to, if you are ready to take risk, you may be able to complete your PhD very soon. If you are like trying to rub those old articles or something like that, there is not risk, it's not risky. You will be well aware of your results, but yes, it may take some time, because there's a lot of competition, because at the end of the day we have to get publications also. Without publications we won't be getting PhDs. So that is what I feel during these 3 years, and I have followed these things.
Sir, as you mentioned, the area of research is very, very important. So, what is your area of research in PhD?
So, actually, I had done my M.tech project on RF VLSA design. So, I was very much into RF VLSA design. But coming to my when I joined PhD, there also, as I said at the time interview, I said that thing. But once I got admission, so I talked to my sir and we sat together. So there are some issues, challenges are there in RF VLSA, which we are not able to do in India. So that was one because PhD is whole new thing. So that was one thing which make me to come to analog. Analog is a bit low frequency, RF is high frequency. So almost domain is same. Then the problem statement, this was about area. Problem statement, it took me around 1 year. I started with memories, working on memories. But the thing was with memories, like if you see now 12 nanometer people are using, for 10 nanometer also some people are using for memories. But we don't have those resources to work on 10 nanometer. So I was working on 180 nanometer. So one semester was over. So we sat again down together, and for future, we thought, what should we do? Because we had to get papers also. So then I started working on sensors. So I have been working on temperature sensors and their interfaces. I have worked on some biomedical sensors also. So it's like more like I'm working on on-chip sensors and with their signal conditioning circuits. So this all, this sensor thing and all thing, it came to me after doing this. I used to sit 1 month or 2 months. I did this thing, that finding what is the recent trend. So this is there also, how to find your problem statement. So two strategies are there which I would like to share with you. So one is, whenever you are interested in some area, okay, you are interested in, let's say, data mining is there, I'm interested in data mining, or I'm interested in some architecture coding. So what I'll do, I'll go to Google Scholar is there, one site is there, Google Scholar. There will be my Gmail account is there, so I'll create alerts there. I'll give some keywords. Let's say some keyword generating algorithm is there. I gave this keyword generating algorithm. So what happens, every week, whenever there is some paper about this genetic algorithm, I'll be getting it in my mail. So from that, I'll be knowing what people are doing in genetic algorithm. So I'll be knowing what is the recent trends in genetic algorithm. So this will help you to build your problem, like let's say in case of genetic algorithm. So that is one thing. Second one is there, this is MIT library is there, MIT University, they have their library. There once you type your your, let's say I'm talking about genetic algorithm, I type genetic algorithm there, it will give you a graph. It will give you pie chart, graphs, many graphs it will give you. It will show you the publication, number of publications which is happening in that particular topic. So when I was working for memories, so I searched there, so it showed me, okay, it is increasing, but from 2012 there's a dip in that publication up on that topic. The dip means that the people are, that topic is almost saturated, people have stopped working on that area. So then similarly, when you go, if you, any topic is there, you search there, if the graph is increasing, that means that people are working there, there is still a lot of work has to be done there. So yes, it is okay for me. But if there is a dip in that graph, like a number of publications in 2010 it was 14, now 2011 it was 78, and 2014 it is 10, that means it has decreased. So people are not finding much applications, much novelties now in that particular topic, so they have stopped working. So you should also stop working. That helped me a lot to find my problem statement also.
So I've seen that this is actually kind of a funny thing, that a lot of people keep their problem statement as very secret. So do you also keep your problem statement secret? I mean, not telling other people?
No, it's not like that.
Okay.
See, once I discussed, it happened with me.
Mm-hmm.
I was not very much sure. I had this small idea about, okay, I'm working on sensors, but I was not sure about what sensors and what should strategy. So I went to some conference and here and there, and there are some forums are there,
mm-hmm.
research forums, which where you can just discuss, and they will tell you, yes, you don't have to go, once you go into it, you don't have to tell that, just
mm-hmm.
in general, we can talk about that.
Okay.
And that's it.
Cool. I mean, you should keep your problem statement a secret.
Yeah. Problem statement is more like a specific, but yes, I can talk about my
area
of research, and
like
I said, I'm working on sensors.
Yeah.
So I'm not going in particular which sensor, at what sensor, how I'm doing all that thing. So that I have to keep with myself.
Yeah.
So
what will be the work plan after we, for example, I found out my problem statement, then what should the work plan to go off through that?
Yes, as I said, that we had to do literature survey,
mm-hmm.
and if I'm trying to complete, if my intention is to complete within 4 years or let's say 3 years also, so I think literature is very, we have to make systematic arrangement of literature survey based on the application, based on the year, based on the journals, and also the people which are, like if you go abroad, there are some research labs are there. So let's say my area is VLSA. So there are some in this MIT Big B University, they are having their own research labs, one faculty. So that faculty, if my area is related to him, I had to follow him, because everything will be there on his page. Like some tutorials will be there, some papers, his recent work, and what projects they are doing. From that, you can get also idea about what you can do. So that is also very helpful.
Okay. And sir, after PhD, I mean, what is the criteria to get the PhD? I mean, I've heard that
in general, there is this, in NITs and IITs, there is this criteria of getting 2 SCI.
Mm-hmm.
So there is just like when we talk about colleges, we talk IITs, NITs,
mm-hmm.
and then other colleges. Similarly, there is generals, they are like SCI one category is here, then there
mm-hmm.
is Scopus is there, and there is non-Scopus.
Mm-hmm.
So in NITs and IITs, the criteria is to get 2 Scopus generals,
mm-hmm.
and let's say 1 or 2 SCI Scopus are conference proceedings.
Mm-hmm.
So two important thing is to get 2 SCI journals. So if you are able to get 2 SCI journals, whenever you are able to get it, so you will be able to complete your PhD. Now coming to IIC Bangalore, actually I spent some time there.
Mm-hmm.
So I seen there it's not mandatory,
mm-hmm.
because whatever they are proposing, whenever they are able to finish it,
mm-hmm.
so they'll be getting their PhD.
Okay.
So that is there, but obviously when they do that work, they'll be getting journals. But I seen there some people who have only one SCI journal, but they are getting their PhD.
And some of the people, they are not comfortable. I mean, if let us suppose most of the BTech students, they are not comfortable with all these terminologies. Can you explain to them what is SCI journal?
SCI is a scientific citation index. There is one organization, Thomson Reuters. They have defined this certain set of papers whose the research level of research and novelty in papers that is very much higher in those journals, and the impact factor, like let's talk about IEEE.
Mm-hmm.
So the impact factor of IEEE is very much high because a lot of people are citing their articles and a lot of people are downloading their articles. So based on that and the level of demand they want, level of work they want from you, so they had defined certain set of journals. Recently, you see UGC also, they defined their, they
mm-hmm.
uploaded, I think, some list of journals which they will be accepting, because nowadays what is happening, a lot of fake journals are there.
Mm-hmm. Correct.
So where we submit our data, where we submit our paper, and after some time we find that it's not SCI, it's not Scopus, or it's not even a journal. So what they steal our work and it's gone.
Correct.
So that is very important. And one more thing is here, like when coming to selecting a journal where I should publish. So yes, if you are doing PhD at some UGC based university, so you have to look for the list of journals which they are available in their site. And first thing, second thing, if you are at NIT or IIT, and you have to go for the SCI list, Thomson and Reuters is a website, you can go there, you can look for the list and you can download that. That is important. And don't go for like non-SCI papers are there which show the impact factor of 9, 5.6 something. That's not true, because even if you go for high impact factors like IEEE, hardly they go for 4 or 5. So that's very important selecting your journal also. And if you are into your third year, you are able to, you have completed your third year, once you submit a journal, it takes like 1 year to come for whether it's accepted or rejected, for review it comes. So if you are submitting your journal after 3 years, that means you have to get your PhD within 1 year, because it's going fourth year now. So you should try to look for a journal which only takes 6 months or 7 months, like that, so that you, before that you will get and you can submit your PhD within 4 years. So that is very important.
So I've seen your work. I mean, I know that you are doing very good work. Mm. And your work is also very, very appreciated from recently. So can you elaborate more about your work and where you presented your research papers and what are the achievements you have got in the last 3 to 4 years in PhD?
So I can't tell in detail what I have done and all that, but yes, I have published around 18 journals, sorry, 18 papers. Out of them, there are some 5-6 journals are also there, and other are conferences. So mostly they are about sensors and interfaces. So the thing is that finding the novelty, and just as soon as you find the novelty and try to implement it, because everyone will be into that topic. So if you just delay it, and yes, your writing skills should be very important for papers, because most of the times I used to get this at the beginning, that the writing is not good, it should be some scientific or that. Okay, when you join PhD, there is one course also for that, so it won't matter much. And yeah, I think in first 2 years of your PhD, you should try to attend conference at least one or two, and try to interact with people who are in your area and try to ask them what they are doing and all that, or meet some faculty, have some insights from him about your area and tell him I am doing this, that. So it is very useful. And what happens in the conference, also in IEEE conference, some experts from abroad, they also come. So it's very good to talk to them and just interact with them. I'm working on this area, how is it going there, people are working there or not. So yes, it's like that.
So sir, what are your future plans now? I mean, maybe in the next 1 or 2 years you'll be able to finish your PhD hopefully.
Mm.
So we hope that you'll be able to finish your PhD maybe in 1 year. So what are your future plans after that?
I think it's a myth, like when I'm joining PhD, so I'll be going for this lectureship, or I'll become a professor and all that. It depends on your interests. It depends on your caliber. If you have that much energy level, or if you are not interested, it depends on your area also. So what happens? There are some areas where we can join R&D also. Now let's if you know about this Make in India thing, lot of this new R&D outlets have been set up by Government of India to encourage people to work for this Make in India. Luckily, I've been also associated with one Make in India program last year. I was at IIC Bangalore. So yes, I'm planning for R&D, because there is scope for me in my area. So So similarly, if at the time of PhD you are not interested in this teaching and you are interested in R&D, so you have to choose that topic, your area of research accordingly, so that you can get R&D. Yes, there are many opportunities there abroad also, and if you are able to complete your PhD in 4 years, you have a very good chance of getting R&D positions at abroad also, in India also, and postdoc also. If I think people who are into this academics, who want to do become professors in some time, postdoc is very good for them. There are a lot of opportunities. Once you're done PhD, you'll be getting these opportunities. So you should go for that.
So that was a very, very nice conversation with you, sir.
Yeah,
I think I'm sure this video will be very, very helpful for the students. So we are just going to wrap up the videos now. So sir, do you want to share anything with the students, like any last few words for the students who are preparing for GATE examination or for PhD examination? So in last few words, how to prepare or anything that you want to share with them?
If you want to do PhD, you should be very much interested in that. Don't go for someone is suggesting you. If someone is suggesting you, don't go for it. If you are not getting job and you want to do PhD, don't do it. Just try to look for some jobs. Okay, 1 year there will be some struggle. Yes, that thing. And second thing is, your B.Tech second year, third year is very important. Even for GATE, even for PhD admissions, it's very important. And for interview, it is your PhD, your M.Tech coursework and your area of research. Yes. One paper, if you have at least one IEEE conference, it will be very beneficial. And then sincerity and hard work is there in PhD. If you just divert from your PhD when you get PhD in first year, it is going to haunt you in your third and fourth year, because you'll be seeing your batchmates going, you'll be seeing your friends, like some people are getting jobs, some people are getting married, some people are having some other investments, and you'll be like stuck in there. Some hole. So yes, first year, second year, once you get PhD admission, first year and second year are very crucial for your PhD. And don't look back, just keep working. If your papers are getting rejected, it's a matter of time. That makes you stronger. So
if you like,
so if you have any queries about PhD or GATE or future, what should we do? Or some people are in dilemma, should I join PhD or not? How to write a question, research paper? You can contact us at gatelectures.com, or you can contact me at mudassir.mir7@gmail.com. It will be, that link will be provided below this video. And thank you all for your time.
Hi all, subscribe to our channel on YouTube and click on the bell icon to get the latest updates. For course inquiries, visit our website www.gatelectures.com, and don't forget to register and subscribe to the latest post section.